AV, we have Erica, who is our board member of the day. We have Julie Treglone, and we have Lindsay DeCoste and Jay on piano today. Unity of Mesa is a loving spiritual community dedicating to enlivening and enriching our spiritual journey and expanding consciousness. And with that, I invite you to take a moment of pause and pray with me this morning. Divine Spirit, we are so grateful for the abundance that we are as a community, the gratitude that is shared among each and every person in this community. We give thanks that everything is unfolding at the right time and in the right way, individually and collectively in this community and in the world at large. We give thanks as we open our hearts and minds in celebration for the unfolding. We give thanks, and so it is, and so we let it be.
We have a few announcements for you. The very first one is the anniversary party, Diamond in the Desert. So it is our 60th anniversary. That is an amazing time for Unity Churches to come to 60 years. And this... So we are celebrating and commemorating, and we are recognizing that we are standing on the shoulders of all who have come before us, celebrating them, and also knowing that we are moving forward in this day and age as the spiritual community is. Victoria Trafton and Barbara Sherrod, will you guys stand up? They are selling tickets. Tickets are $20 for adults, and they are $10 for youth. And it's going to be a party. It's really going to be a party. It's not just going to be, you know, how sometimes you go to these things. This is going to be a party. There's some music. There's some dancing. There's some information. It's going to be fun. So get your tickets. You have to get them prior to the event, because on the day of the event, there will be no tickets sold. And you'll be like, oh, I'm so sorry, I'm not going. And that's the way it is. So get them soon for the 20th. The second piece for the anniversary is that on big anniversaries, we like to leave a beautiful gift. And since this is a community, a spiritual community that enjoys sound healing, a New Mexican artist has created this beautiful instrument that's also a sculpture. And when you hit the blue squares, it makes a sound. I have not yet done this, but I have heard from Indy. And if you were here last week, she went boom, 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 boom. It will set up here, but it will be available for you guys to come and play with, to get some sound healing on a Sunday morning, to enjoy the vibration of it all. So that is a possibility to give in the bookstore. You can give on Venco. You can write a check and put 60th anniversary gift on it, however you'd like to do it. But we are leaving a legacy for the 60th, and this is the legacy.
And with that said, our continued legacy, we are having new members class coming up Sunday, October 13th, and it's going to be at 11:30, so it's just enough time to grab something from hospitality and join us for those of you who would love to become new members and become a part of the future of our community.
And the pet blessing.
And the pet blessing is also going to be right before. So bring your pets, and if you have any snakes, I'll be out the door, and Reverend Nickie will be out the door. Bring them to Reverend Mindy, and we will be happy to bless the extended members of your family.
Yes, Reverend Mindy will say, oh, how beautiful. We also have gong healing on Wednesday night. It begins at 7 o'clock on this coming Wednesday night, October 7th, 2nd, not the 7th, October 7th. October 2nd at 7 o'clock. It's a beautiful time of sound vibration, of being able to let our bodies come into alignment and to heal. And then the following Wednesday night on October 9th, we have our healing night resuming. Our beautiful Stephanie is back, and we are resuming our healing night, and that's going to be a lot of fun too. So now I'm going to invite you to stand as you are able, to put some joy in your voice, to put some joy in your movement, and let's sing. comes up here to do Diversity Sunday, since it is the last Sunday of the month, turn to somebody and say, "You are the light and the love and the glory."
Hello, everyone. Got to make sure I can work the gadget here. There it is. I'm Lori Weber. I'm one of the board members and delighted to bring Diversity Sunday to you today. At Unity, we believe that all are created with sacred worth. We strive for our ministries and all our outreach activities to be inclusive, open-minded, and free from discrimination. We recognize and honor the divine within as the one common denominator that we all share on our human journey. So today, synchronicity, I love that, we are going to honor the land we are standing on. Mesa, I'm a Casa Grande girl. And I remember when I was in fourth grade in Casa Grande, which means grand house, that we took a field trip to a national monument that's just actually closer to Coolidge than it is Casa Grande. And it was created by the ancient Pima and Pueblo Native Americans around the 13th to 14th century. And they abandoned it about the 14th century. It was made from the soil, and they believe it was with the Odom tribes and the Hohokam people. And I remember in Casa Grande, I had my tonsils out at the Homako Hospital, right? So that whole area there is in tribute to the Native Americans that established that area. All right. So let's talk about the religious holidays coming up this October. And the first is Rosh Hashanah, the Jewish holiday. It's the Jewish New Year, and it begins at sundown. It's a time of introspection and prayer, abstinence. Next is from the Hindu religion, Navaratri. It means nine nights. And it's a Hindu festival, 9 days, where they honor the divine mother. Her name was Durga, and she was the wife of Shiva. And they have huge festivals. I have good friends in California that actually live at an ashram, and their whole year is filled with Hindu festivals. Next, St. Francis Day. One of my favorite songs, The Prayer of St. Francis. It's a Christian recognition of the service to people of the natural world practiced by St. Francis. At Unity of Mesa, we celebrate St. Francis Day on October 13th, when we're going to have our pet blessing. Next is Yom Kippur. This is the holiest day in the Jewish religion. It begins at sundown, and it's observed by strict fasting and ceremonial repentance. Ooh, October 31st, not only Halloween, but it's Reformation Day. And this is when the Protestants separated themselves from the Roman Catholic Church. They wanted more of an emphasis on the Bible teachings. And then All Hallows Eve. Who's got their Halloween costume picked out? Okay, good. Right, All of Hallows Eve is a Christian holiday. It's celebrating the mystery. And we combine prayer and merriment involving children, and it has evolved to what we know as Halloween. Following that is All Saints Day, where we celebrate the saints who have departed. And then the Mexico tradition we'll talk about is after that with Dia los Muertos, right? The Day of the Dead, where they celebrate the union again of the living and the departed. All interesting. Ooh. Leave it to Reverend Mindy to find the common denominator not just the fact that they were in the movies, and they are quite dapper British gentlemen there. Who is that? Those are both James Bond 007 actors, right? So Roger Moore, the one on your right, he was the third actor to play in the James Bond films. He was discovered by the movie director when he was a kid. The movie director called the police. And Roger Moore's father was the policeman that went to the house. And he discovered Roger Moore and put him in the movies. On the left there, who's that one? Sean Connery. Sean Connery actually died on October 31st, and Roger Moore was born on October 14th. So there's that connection Reverend Mindy found for us. And Sean Connery was the first to play James Bond on the big screen. He was quite the bodybuilder, and he considered playing for the British Professional Soccer League. You might know the Manchester United, but he turned it down for his career. Okay, coming up, national holidays in October. Taco Tuesday, and it's on the 1st, and it is a Tuesday, for those of you that like that. Right? October 11th, coming out day, right? And this is awareness and respect and loving our friends and family of the LGBTQ plus communities. It was actually founded in 1988, and they changed the kind of focus of coming out day, and recently it's now coming out against hate. So we want to honor all our friends and loved ones. 12th, Loving Yarn Day. Reptile Awareness Day. And of course, on the 29th, Cat Appreciation Day. And just in honor of cats, and we know what cats are like, they actually have 25 days throughout the calendar year where we celebrate them. And that's Diversity Sunday. Thank you.
Hello, everyone. I'm super excited for our Sunday today. In YFM, we're going to be having chair yoga. It's the fifth Sunday, so we get to do something special. And special tea and special Ayurvedic snacks. Like, wow, our kids get it so good. And then after that, we're inviting everybody in the congregation and all our kids, of course, who will be there already, to come over to the annex because we have an art show. As many of you would know, our youth did some painting with a view to having it being auctioned off today as a fundraiser for our youth program, which helps send our kids off to summer camp and all sorts of other fun things that we do throughout the year. So we want you to come over and support that and be prepared to make a bid on the children's artwork. And the highest bid is going to win. We're going to announce that before noon, so don't go away if you want to know if your bid was the winner or not, and then we'll chase you up for the money. Also, we're going to celebrate this event with some special hospitality, so sparkling drinks, cheese, crackers, fruit, and it's going to be a good time of just getting to know one another and celebrating our kids and their creativity, so be there. It'll be great. That's it. We've got some other fun events coming up. I keep the parents and families informed, and we also share it with you as well, so we'll be doing that in future. Kira, would you like to come up here? We're going to have an affirmation.
I move in harmony with divine. Please say it with me. I move in harmony the divine.
Kira. Kira. Thank you, Kira. That's always a part of the deal. If you do the affirmation, you get to do the chime to punctuate the meaning. Let's say our blessing for our children before we sing them out for their program this morning. Children, we love you, we bless you, we appreciate you, and we behold the Christ you are.
If there's a dream in your heart, go for it. If you're treading new ground or fighting the same old battle, don't give up. Continue to dream, plan, and do. Try something different if you're stuck. Do whatever your heart tells you. Give yourself credit for all you've accomplished. Most dreams that come true are born out of desire and fueled by preparation and action. Don't be afraid. You can do it. I know you can.
MJ. How beautiful that is. Thank you so much. Trials into triumph. Have any of you ever had any trials? Really, the better question is probably, have any of you not? And yet, if we're truly in alignment with the truth of ourselves, we have within us everything that is needed to navigate those trials. But do you ever forget that? Sometimes I forget that. Sometimes I forget that. And sometimes I take it one more step further. So-and-so, whoever so-and-so is, another name for God probably, but so-and-so is in my way. Have you ever had that feeling? Like somebody is trying to be in the way of your pathway, getting to where you want to go. Have you ever had that experience? Some of you are saying yes, and some of you are saying no. It's an interesting thing being human as well as spiritual. It's an interesting thing to find a way to live as a spiritual being, being human, and learning to be human, because it's not like we come in here knowing how to be a human being. We come in here as a spiritual being knowing exactly how to do that, because that's who we are. It's our very nature. So then we have to step into figuring out how to be human, and we usually look outside of ourselves for that. That's how they did it. Maybe I'm going to try that. Oh, that's how they did it, and I know not to try that. We watch, we observe. It's called observational learning. And yet, sometimes from our observational learning, we pick up this idea that if the environment would change out there, then we would be okay. If something would just change out there, if something would just be different out there, then I would not be feeling what I'm feeling in here. And yet, we have the capacity, and I think the responsibility or the response agility, to learn how to discipline our mind and allow what's in here to be as unaffected as possible about what's out here. So Eric Butterworth would call it living from within out. So we have to learn, instead of living from without in, to learn to live from within out. And to know that whatever happens out here in our lives, whether it comes from another person or an idea within our mind, that whatever we think about it, that God means it for good, the God within us. And we have the capacity to tune in because we have all of the capacities of God and step forward from our inner guidance. This verse in Genesis, even though you intended to harm me, because sometimes we think somebody else intends to harm us, even though you intended to harm me, God intended only for good. It's a fascinating Bible verse. Sometimes we think that we're at the effect of other people. They're doing something to us. You might have heard other people say that, or you might have heard that come out of your mouth. I can honestly say I have heard that come out of my mouth. And then I have to step back into the truth of me, to step back into the knowingness that I have the capacity and the ability to turn anything around, that the only one who can harm my inner peace is me, when I allow that to be. The only one. So one of the best stories to illustrate this in Genesis 50:20 actually comes from this story, is the story of Joseph in the Bible. Genesis 37, chapter 37, all the way to the end of Genesis 50, tells the story of Joseph. I promise you, I won't go into great detail for those many verses or many chapters, but I do want to highlight a little bit. Joseph was the 11th son of Jacob. Do you remember Jacob who wrestled with the angel saying, tell me your name and show me your face? We often wrestle with angels when there's a problem that we have, when there's something that we're trying to figure out, and it's an ongoing something that we're trying to figure out. We're wrestling with that idea. Well, Jacob wrestled with that idea of who he was and who God was for most of his life. And he passed on his knowledge to his sons. He had 12 sons. Some people say that these 12 sons are the early precursors of the 12 powers that Charles Fillmore, one of the co-founders of Unity, put together. And if you go back and you can find the list of those 12 powers, they look very different than the list of the 12 powers that we have today, although there's some that are similar. So this story is the beginning part of those powers, those capacities of God that Unity teaches that we have within all of us. So Joseph was the 11th son of Jacob and a woman named Rachel. And at 17, Joseph would go into the fields with his brothers, and they would put together wheat or corn, or they would put together grain, depending on which translation of the Bible that you read. They would put together, and they would make these sheaves. So it would be like going into the fields and seeing these wheat sheaves standing up and overflowing and tied together so that they're not just laying on the ground getting wet and getting damp and rotting. They're standing up. So Joseph would be helping his brothers, and one day he said to his brothers, remember, he's 17 years old, you know, I had a dream. I had a dream that all of these sheaves circled around me, and all of these sheaves are you. And I was in the center, and the sheaves bowed down to me. Can you imagine? I've never been an older brother. I've never even been an older sister, because I was the baby. But can you imagine what that was like for an older brother? What do you mean we're going to bow down to you? That was my first thought. What do you mean we're going to bow down to you? So can you imagine they were jealous? Can you imagine they thought that Joseph was arrogant? I would have thought Joseph was arrogant at that point. Can you imagine the jealousy that they had? So Joseph goes back home, and instead of talking about his brothers in a positive way, he starts some gossip. And what he does is he tells his father, he tells Jacob, all the things that the brothers are doing wrong. And of course, he tells the father all the things that he's doing right. Does this sound human? Remember, the Bible at this point is really looking at human beings' journey across time and journey in consciousness. So his consciousness is not standing in the highest and best for all at this point. But he's 17 years old. He's got a lot to learn. I had a lot to learn at 17. I thought I was grown when I was 17. Now I look back at it and I kind of laugh at it, because I so was not. But Jacob had Joseph late in life. And he had Jacob with a woman named Rachel who he loved dearly. And so one of our human tendencies is to dote on somebody that we love dearly. And so that's exactly what Jacob did. He put all this energy into Joseph. He told Joseph how wonderful, how marvelous he was. And he did not give, Jacob did not give the same consideration to the brothers. Now, Joseph stands for imagination in the 12 powers. And I'm going to ask you to call forth your imagination to think about what it might have been like to be one of those brothers. To have a real clear sense that your father loved a different brother more than you. I would think that was difficult. And then think about what would come under that. Jealousy, hurt, defensiveness. And one of the ways that Jacob showed his love for Joseph was he made him a tunic a tunic that was multicolored, a tunic that was beautiful, embroidered in all these different colors. If you think about it, you might have heard of the play Joseph and the Coat of Many Colors. Well, it was a tunic. So Joseph, you know, we like to strut our stuff, right? We like to strut our clothes at times. So he and his tunic went to see his brothers, and he gets there, and his brothers see him coming from across the fields, and they're like, oh, here he comes again. Here he comes again. Let's just kill him. That was what they said. Let's just kill him. And one of the brothers said, oh, I don't think that's a very good idea. But the brothers took Joseph and threw him down in a cistern. It turned out that there was no water in it. And the brother who didn't want to hurt Joseph thought, well, I'll just go back and pull him out later. And while Joseph's in the cistern, can't get out because it's impossible to get out by yourself, the brothers sat down to eat. And across the way, coming across the land, they see a caravan. And they think, well, you know, instead of killing him, we could just say sell him, and we can make some money on it. Now, does this sound familiar? Let's just sell him and make some money on it. Okay, we're often selling things to make some money on it. So they take Joseph out of the cistern. They sell him to this caravan that's traveling across to Egypt. It's headed for Egypt. And they get 20 pieces of silver with that sale. And off they go doing their thing. And Reuben comes back and he freaks out because he goes to the cistern. He's going to pull Joseph out with a rope. And there is no Joseph. So he freaks out. And the brothers tell him, well, we decided to sell Joseph instead of kill Joseph. We thought it would be better for us and better for Joseph. So off Joseph goes to Egypt. And what happens is he gets sold to a man called Potiphar. And Joseph, can you imagine how you would be feeling if you had been sold? I'd be mad. I'd be really mad. I'd probably be very scared. I'd feel helpless. All of these human emotions are going to come up. But we don't see any of that with Joseph, which is part of what is amazing about how he can use his imagination. He's sold to this man, Potiphar, who's a rich man. And he begins to serve in Potiphar's house. So think about it. If I had had this abrupt change in my life, it might take a lot for me to get to the point of saying, oh, what somebody else means for harm, God is going to do good works with. And to be in alignment, to be in a flow with it, to not resist it, and just to begin to serve, to know who he is enough, to stand in his power enough, to be strong enough, to just begin to serve. And this verse, God intended only for good. In Hebrew, Joseph means to add to. So imagine, use your imagination here, to add to. God means this for good. I'm going to simply serve. No matter what's going on out here, I'm going to come in here and I'm going to serve. I'm going to do the best I can. And so what ends up happening is Potiphar's wealth grows. Joseph is serving him. Joseph is serving everyone in that household. And Potiphar's wealth is growing. And Joseph is doing the absolute best he can. So we can see some maturity from the 17-year-old with the events that occurred, with the trials that happened in his life. We can see some maturity beginning to happen, some opening up of a new level of consciousness in Joseph. And Joseph continues to serve. He continues to create abundance for Potiphar. And then the upper limit happens. Potiphar's wife takes a shine to Joseph. And she comes at him. And he is like, nope, this is my employer. I'm serving Potiphar. There's a reason why you and I haven't had much interaction. But one day, the wife grabs Joseph's coat and tries to pull Joseph to her, and he slips out of his coat, leaving his coat, remember this beautiful tunic that his father has given him, behind. So it's very distinctive. And Potiphar comes home, and imagine what he thought. Hey, what have you been doing? Well, the wife says, you know, he tried to come on to me. He tried to rape me. And so Potiphar takes Joseph and puts him into prison. Now, Joseph knows who he is. He knows that he did not do anything. Potiphar makes an assumption. Here's what's going on in the outer world. He makes an assumption. The wife just keeps, Potiphar's wife just keeps telling the same old story. Not a true story, but you know, people believe things. They believe things based on their own consciousness. And sometimes people will tell us a story that's not true, but we will take it as fact. So Joseph goes into the prison, and he does what Joseph does. He begins to serve in the prison. He begins support in the prison. And soon the prison guards are recognizing this behavior. Wow, you've just been thrown in prison for something that you say you didn't do, but somebody else says you did do, but it got you in prison. And here you are serving. Here you are giving to others. Here you are helping people. And he begins to be noticed. Notice because of the light that's shining in him. Notice because of the belief that God intended only for good. How different would your life be? How different would my life be? If I could hold that phrase in everything that happens, God intends it only for good. Jesus backed that statement up when he came and he said, it is the Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom, to give you the consciousness of God. It is the God's good pleasure, if you're uncomfortable with the term Father, for you to have all the good that you can be open to receiving. Now, it might not look like we want it to look. I don't imagine that being in prison was how Joseph wanted it to look. But what happened was that he said, okay, here I am. No resistance. To our understanding, no playing victim. To our understanding, acceptance and allowing what is unfolding in his life as God is intending this for good. So what does he do? He serves. And then eventually, the Pharaoh of Egypt has these two high people in his court. One of them is a baker, and one of them is the cupbearer. A cupbearer would taste the wine or taste the drink or taste something prior to the Pharaoh, so the Pharaoh wouldn't be poisoned. And they get in trouble with the Pharaoh, so into prison they go. Boom. They're not as happy as Joseph is. But one night they have a dream. And in their dream, what they're doing is shared with Joseph. And Joseph says to him, you know, only God can interpret the dream, but tell me what your dream was, and I will help you out. So the dream for the cupbearer was that he was going to be able to go back and serve the Pharaoh. And the dream for the cupbearer, for the baker, as Joseph shared it and interpreted it, was that in 3 days' time, he would be impaled by a pole and die. So the Pharaoh gets over being upset, calls the cupbearer and the baker back, and what do you think happens? The two dreams come true. So Joseph is getting a reputation now of being able to interpret dreams. So then one night, the Pharaoh has a dream. And he tries to talk to people and said, who would be the best person? Somebody says, well, you know, there's this guy in prison. His name is Joseph. And he interprets dreams. And he's very accurate because the cupbearer and the baker, exactly what they dreamed came forth. So Pharaoh calls Joseph and Joseph comes in and he interprets the dream. And he says, okay, we're going to have these many years of abundance and great harvest, and then after 7 years, we're going to begin to have famine. And so what the dream is telling you, Pharaoh, is to save up a fifth of your stores so that when the famine comes, there will be food for everybody. Let's take a look at this. Joseph begins as the son of Jacob. Something happens. You know, something happens. It's really another name for God. Something happens. And Joseph becomes a slave in Potiphar's house. And then something else happens, and he becomes a prisoner. And then something else happens, and he becomes a ruler. He moves from son to slave to prisoner to ruler. And as best we can tell from the stories written in the Bible, Joseph allows this to happen, holding on to the truth of himself, holding on to the lessons that his father Jacob has taught him about God, holding on to the beliefs that he holds clearly. And he's able to, in his imagination, simply see more. And that's what happened. Son to slave to prisoner to ruler. More kept coming. And eventually, Joseph was one of the biggest leaders in Egypt. And what happened? As the leader, he began to listen to that dream. He listened to the dream that he had interpreted from Pharaoh, and he started to set back 1/5 of all of the harvest for 7 years. And when the famine began, the Pharaoh remembered, this is exactly what you said would happen. And Joseph had simply followed the inner guidance that he had received. And the lands of Egypt had plenty, and the surrounding lands had famine. They had not prepared, but they had also not known to prepare. So eventually, the land of Canaan, where Joseph's brothers and father still lived, they heard that in Egypt there was plenty. And Jacob sends his sons, says, go and take your sacks, take some silver, and buy some food in Egypt. So the sons come, all but the youngest son. The son, and his name is Benjamin. The sons come, and they come to where Joseph is working and supporting people buying this grain. And Joseph recognizes his brothers, but his brothers don't recognize him because they had sold him into slavery. Who would have thought in this action that eventually he would be the ruler of the land of Egypt? Son to slave, prisoner to ruler. All because he followed his inner guidance. He lived in his imagination. He was willing to mature his imagination and grab hold of it. And so what does he do? He tells the people, fill their sacks, but return their money. And then he puts a cup in one of the sacks of grain, a silver cup that's his cup that's identifiable. And the brothers head back home with their grain, not knowing that there's money, the money that they had brought was still in the sacks, having no idea. So can you imagine what happened when they open them up and there's the grain and there's the money and there's this cup that belongs to Joseph? They don't know whose it is, but they know it's a high ruler because of how it's made. Somebody important. So if you were to open that up, the sack of grain, and there's your money, and you had been in the consciousness of selling your brother to a slave caravan, what do you think your first thought would be? My first thought would be, they think I'm a thief, because that's how their consciousness is. They think I'm a thief. So they got very worried, and they took the grain back, and they took the money back. And one of the things Joseph said, they still don't recognize Joseph. Bring your youngest brother. And they're like, oh, our dad will never let us bring our youngest brother. Because think about Jacob. Jacob sent Joseph off to the fields, and Joseph never returned. The brothers had killed a goat, slathered his clothing in it, and taken it back, and told the father that Joseph was dead. So the father, Jacob, is mourning. So can you see how all these pieces, It takes a lot of pieces, right? It takes a lot of different pieces to come together in this moment of redemption. So one of the brothers stays back in Egypt, and the other brothers go and they bring Benjamin. And Benjamin recognizes Joseph. That's my brother. That's my brother. And what happens? There's reconciliation. There's reuniting of the family. Here's Joseph, who knows that what somebody else means for harm can be utilized for good when we're willing to stay steadfast in our belief that we are divine. When we're willing to stand steadfast in our belief that we have everything that we need. And Joseph did this through every stage, son to slave, to prisoner to ruler. And reconciliation happened. This is an amazing story of who we are becoming in the Bible, who we can be. It's an amazing story of how if we stop worrying about a lot of other things, that we can truly stand in our power, to stand in our imagination and rework the world so that it works for us, no matter what's going on outside of us. How do we be like Joseph? Gay Hendricks has this idea of two file cabinets. So I have two file cabinets for you. In those two file cabinets, one of them is what can I control? What can I control in my life? I can control me. I can control my thoughts. I can navigate my emotions. I can choose my behavior. I can make the difference between reacting and responding to life. And then there's what's out of my control. What anybody else does, what anybody else says about us, what anybody else feels about us, all of those are out of our control. We have no control over that. But most people, many people, not you guys, I'm sure, put their energy into out of my control file cabinet. Well, if I just be different, so-and-so might like me. It's a thought. It's a thought that most of us have had. And yet, I could be different and they still may not like me. I could be different and maybe they'll like me, but then am I being authentic? So all of these things come about. But we have these two file cabinets. What I can control, and when we focus our energy on what we can control, who am I? What do I know about spiritual principle? Am I willing to live spiritual principle no matter what's happening outside of me? Then we can put all of our energy into that I can control file cabinet. Somebody gossips about us, and we say, oh, that's out of my control. That's in my I cannot control file cabinet. I believe I'm going to just leave it there. They can say whatever they say, and whatever happens to me, I can know that it is intended for good, that everything in my life is moving toward me understanding my own magnificence and living my life authentically and fully as I am. Faith, courage, strength, love. When we bring these components to our lives, it takes faith to do what Joseph did, to just allow what was happening to be happening in his life and to hold the faith that God meant it for good. It takes faith to have courage to stand and say, whatever you think about me, that's you, and whatever I think about me, that's me. And my opinion is the one that is leading and guiding me. Whatever is happening out here is happening, and it may feel chaotic or it may feel peaceful, but I am in control of what's happening in here. I am in control of my own inner peace, and nothing out here can stop me from finding my inner peace. Strength. It takes strength to go against collective consciousness. It takes strength to go against your best friend or maybe your partner who has a different belief system or a different idea of how something should be done. But if you're called to do it the way that you were called to do it, stand in your power, stand in your strength. But most of all, love. Love is who we are. It's who we were created as, not who we were created to be, but who we are created as. So the moment we get out of alignment with love, then we're going to feel awkward or wobbly or uncomfortable. And it's not easy in the face of some of the things that are happening out here to stand in love. It's not easy in the face of somebody who has an opinion about you that's different from your opinion about yourself to stand in love, and yet that's what we're called to do. Because when we do that, we are in alignment. And it takes discipline and it takes practice. It takes our willingness to be uncomfortable at times. It takes our willingness to draw forth our courage. These are things that I'm imagining, faith and courage and strength and love, that Joseph needed to be able to continue on from son to slave to prisoner to ruler. He showed his faith. He showed his faith. He showed his courage. He showed his strength. And he showed his love at the end with reconciliation with brothers who had sold him into slavery. I have to say, I don't know if I could do that. That's a tough one. And yet, we face different kinds of tough issues in our lives. And when we practice our spiritual practices, when we spend time in prayer and meditation, when we come together collectively as a spiritual community, when we support each other in love, when we say, how can I best support you no matter what's happening in your life? How can I be present for you no matter what's happening in your life? How can I remind you of who you are, divine in nature, with all of the capacities of God? How can I do that? So that you are able to stand in faith and courage and strength and love and live your life. Romans says, so we can be so sure that every detail in our lives of love for God is worked into something good. We think this is actually Paul's writing. We can be so sure that every detail in our lives of love is God, for God, is worked into something good. Love. Love for God. We are divine, so we're also talking about love for ourselves. Each of us in this room and each person on this planet is divine. So we're also talking about love for each person. Even when they don't seem loving, we might have to take a few breaths, bring ourselves back home in our heart, and be love. Charles Fillmore says, when the harshness of others seems to crush you, you can send forth love, the power that not only blesses you, but goes forth to redeem the adverse conditions in the outer. When life seems harsh, love. Put your hand on your heart, if you will, right now, and think about a difficulty in your life. Maybe it's a trial. Maybe it's just a little bump in the road. And breathe into your heart. And breathe out of your heart for a moment. But breathe into your heart. And then breathe out to that condition, that bump in the road, that obstacle, that trial. And let's do it again. Breathe into your heart. Feel your heart open. You might even smile at your heart in this moment. Feel it opening. And breathe out to that thing that you feel like is a hindrance in the outer world. And let's do it one more time. Bring your hand to your heart. Use your imagination if you need to. Bring forth your Joseph quality of steadfastness, of knowing beyond a shadow of a doubt that what anything or anyone else means for harm, that the God within you means for good. Our job is simply to listen, to love, to know who we are, to have faith and courage, to call upon our strength and live in love and send your love out. And we know that what we love changes the vibration because we are one. It changes the vibration for everyone if they're open-minded. to receiving? What are you open to receiving right now? Are you open to receiving peace and harmony? Are you open to receiving love? If you're interested in this, I'm going to read this and then I'm going to invite you to say it with me. I embrace the power of love and choose to call it forth in all areas of my life. That's exactly what Joseph did. He did it through his imagination. But love and imagination can support each other. I embrace the power of love and choose to call it forth in all areas of my life. If this is something that you're interested in, if this is something you want, if being as Joseph was, that no matter what occurred in his life, that he was prospered, that he stood strong, then say this with me together. I embrace the power of love and choose to call it forth in all areas of my life. I want to circle back to that first dream that Joseph had when he was 17. The dream that upset his brothers. The dream that made him look arrogant in the way he shared it. That dream actually came into manifestation for Joseph, because in the end, as he was the ruler of Egypt, the brothers brought their sacks, their empty sacks, and filled them with wheat, filled them with grain. And Joseph just simply gave their money back and said, with a few steps, you're my brothers. I'm giving this to you. So in the end, the brothers were grateful and actually bowed down to Joseph. So that dream, which looked arrogant, in conscious maturity came true for Joseph and became forgiveness and reconciliation and love. When we are willing to live principle, when we are willing to stand in love no matter what's happening out here, then that's exactly what ends up happening. I'm going to invite you to tune into your hearts as we move into a time of meditation and sing our way in with I Am Opening. If you're willing, imagine through the words of this song that you are opening. That you are opening to the abundance that's available to you. That you are opening to the peace that is available to you. And that your heart is ready to receive the love that is here for all of us. Moment we truly have as we move into a time of meditation. Notice where you are open and notice where you're not open, and love them both equally. Notice where your resistance is in life and love that as equally as you love your surrendering and your allowing. Love the resistance as much as you love the flow of life, the peace of life, the harmony of life, the joy of life. Love, that energy that emanates from our hearts, and wants the best for ourselves and everyone else. That energy that emanates from our hearts and is the light of the world. That energy that comes from our hearts and is in total alignment with who we are. Love and imagination. Love. Love. And love. We take these thoughts into a moment of silence. Divine order unfolded for Joseph, from son to slave, to prisoner to ruler. It didn't look like what most of us would think divine order looks like. And yet, as Joseph was willing to use his spiritual understanding and to allow his consciousness to expand his awareness of truth, his awareness of who he was, his ability to stay focused on God, to stay focused on knowing beyond a shadow of a doubt that what others may mean will harm to us. When we stand in the truth of ourselves, it is only good. So we bless that good in this moment. We bless all of the parts of us in that moment. The resistance and the openness. We bless the hurt and the support that we have. We bless the defensiveness and the jealousy with love, knowing that who we truly are is love. And we learn step by step to live in the divine order of that love as it comes forth within us and through us and touches every life that we touch. And so it is, and so we allow that to bring forth love in every area and aspect of our lives. Amen.
Amen. Yes. So as a long-term truth student of unity, reminders like that and awareness of the principles and tools have helped me personally walk through some of the most difficult times. So thank you for that reminder. So now is the time for our offering. There are many ways to give. You can text. You can use the Venco app. You can give through the bookstore. You can give through regular mail, snail mail. And you can also give through this very sacred process of passing of the baskets. If you do not have a monetary offering at this time, please feel free to put your love, your energy, some peace in there. So we can say together our offering blessing. Divine love through and as me blesses and multiplies all that I have, all that I give, and all that I receive. And so it is. And we give thanks for each gift, and we really give thanks for each giver.
shot to dark horse runners, hairbrush singers, dashboard drummers. Hello, you wild magnolias, just waiting to bloom. Inside of me and you, thank God even crazy dreams come true. I've stood at the bottom of some walls I thought I couldn't climb. I felt like Cinderella at the ball, just running out of time. So I know how it feels to be afraid, think that it's all gonna slip away. Hold on, hold on. Here's to your free souls, you firefly chasers, tree climbers, porch singers, air guitar players. And here's to you, fearless dancers, shaking walls in your bedroom. There's a lot of wonder left inside of me and you. Thank God even crazy dreams come true. Never let a bad day be enough to go and talk you into giving up. Sometimes everybody feels like you, just like you. Some difference makers, small town heroes and big chance takers. I've met some young hearts with something to prove. Oh yeah, here's to you long shots, you dark horse runners, hairbrush singers and dashboard drummers. Here's to you wild magnolias, just waiting to bloom. Inside of me and you, thank God even crazy dreams come true. Thank God even crazy dreams come true.
Oh, how beautiful, Lindsay and Jay. Our crazy dreams do come true. How many of you have had a crazy dream come true? I have. It's really fun. That's part of how I'm here, and I love it. I love it. Let's bless our offering from our hearts and from our solar plexus and all the different parts of us. Together, we are one with the opulence of God. We are now in the flow of infinite abundance, and we give thanks for the prosperity that is ours by divine right.
Yay. Thank you for being here. I love when she does that. Please join us for the art show in the annex. It's the building next to us. And also, we'll be having hospitality over there today. And also, there are tickets. Barbara and Victoria are selling tickets. Do we have any of our prayer chaplains that are available to pray? They will be over here. Thank you. Delaine, Jim, and John will also be here. Thank you. And myself, I will be over here as well.
Sharon.
And Sherry. Thank you. Thank you for joining us. And let's go ahead and have a wonderful week.
Yes. And remember who you are and what you are. And I want to also remind you, just in case you've been wondering where Reverend Mindy is, she is having a delightful time with her youngest son, Chris, and his fiancée, Kara, on the island of Oahu, hanging out with them, playing, and just soaking up her brand of paradise. Have the best week ever. Love as much as you can from where you are, and know that that is enough, because you are enough.
Patsy Dargos runners, hairbrush singers, dashboard drummers. Here's to you, wild magnolias, just waiting to bloom.